Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst 5th November 2018. Today we will be discussing 5 topics for prelims. Of them, the first topic is related with the state of public procurement in India. The second article is related with the concept of water ATMs. And the third one is related with the return of Greater Flamingos to Coringa Wildlife Sanctuary in Andhra Pradesh. Fourth one is related with RBI's proposal to set up public credit registry in India. The last one is related with Exim Bank. Let's move to the first item. The article has been taken from PIB. In PIB, there was a news about a conference being organized by Competition Commission of India on the topic of competition law and public procurement in India. In the point of examination, public procurement becomes more important. So we will have a brief look into public procurement in India. What is public procurement? Public procurement is a purchase of goods and services by the public sector, that is by the government, and is a key economic activity of governments, accounting for 15% of country's GDP all over the world. The average value is 15%, and whereas in India, the public procurement constitutes about 30% of GDP. So this indicates why public procurement is important for India. Government has launched a series of policy measures to boost public procurement in India. Government has launched a series of policy measures to boost the public procurement from micro and small enterprises. In 2012, procurement policy was launched by the government. It mandated that the central government departments and central public sector units had to procure necessarily a minimum of 20% from micro and small enterprises. Apart from that, the government also undertook few important measures. Now, recently, the government has updated this minimum requirement of 20% to 25%. It is a welcome move. Apart from this, the government has also undertaken few measures like government e-marketplace and MSME Samband portal in order to boost the public procurement from MSMEs. A recent amendment made to this public procurement order has given more importance to Make in India initiative undertaken by Government of India. It aims at promoting manufacturing and production of goods and services in India with the mandatory minimum local content of 50%. The next article is related with water ATMs. What are these water ATMs? Water ATMs are dispensation systems which dispense water when a coin or smart card is inserted. The Safe Water Network and non-governmental organization have proposed that these water ATMs may act as a solution to India's water problem. So what is the state of India's water problem? In the Composite Water Management Index of Niti Aayog, it was concluded that almost 70% of drinking water in India is contaminated. In water quality index, India stands 120th among 122 countries. This indicates the dire state of water quality in India. Apart from this, there is also supply side issues, which is mentioned by CAG report on National Rural Drinking Water Program. The report suggests that only 18% of the rural population has access to potable piped water. So we have quality issue, we have supply issue. These water ATMs located along rural areas and urban areas will have a major role to answer the questions posed by the concerns of quality and concerns of supply. So we spoke about water contamination in India. So contamination needs an agent, that is pollutant. What are the major pollutants of water, drinking water in India? The major pollutants are nitrate, fluoride, iron, salinity, arsenic, lead, chromium, cadmium. Also, in few parts of Punjab, due to high extraction of groundwater, the traces of uranium was found in drinking water. So this becomes more important. Please remember these facts. UPSC may ask question about the pollutants, water pollutants. Remembering these chemical pollutants becomes important. Let's move to the next article. Next article is about the arrival of greater flamingos in Coringa Wildlife Sanctuary. Greater flamingos are the most widespread and largest species of flamingo family. And what is the geographical spread of flamingos habitat? It is found in three continents. It's found in Africa, Indian subcontinent and Middle East of Asia, and in southern part of Europe. The presence of greater flamingos in a wetland ecosystem indicates healthy coastal environment, because the greater flamingos feed on brine shrimps and algae and the abundant amount of brine shrimps and algae present in a wetland ecosystem indicates that the wetland is in healthy state. UPSC has the practice of asking about the IUCN status of different animal species that has come in use. So the greater flamingo is it's been accorded the status of least concern by IUCN. Let's see a few important details about the Koringa Wildlife Sanctuary. Koringa Wildlife Sanctuary is located along the eastern coast of India in the state of Andhra Pradesh. The wildlife sanctuary forms the second largest mangrove forest in India after Sundarbans. It is a highly biodiverse area with 24 mangrove tree species and it houses more than 120 bird species. It is also home to critically endangered scavenger species like white-backed vulture and long-billed vulture. Apart from this, this Koringa Wildlife Sanctuary also witnesses the Aribara, the mass nesting of olive ridley turtles. There was a question in UPSC prelims about Koringa Wildlife Sanctuary and the Aribara. And one of the most important site under this Koringa Wildlife Sanctuary is Hope Island. Hope Island is a pit formed by the sedimentation of Godavari River. And Hope Island was recently in news because of a mass suicide committed by the olive ridleys. The next article is about the RBI's proposal to set a public credit registry in India. So, what is a public credit registry? Public credit registry is an information repository that collates all credit related information of individuals and corporate borrowers. Indian banking system is now facing the crisis of bad loans. In order to address this menace of bad loans, information about the quality of credit is required. And an absence of public credit registry didn't help this case, and the non-availability of information about the value of assets has created problems in policy making related with banking system in India. So, what is the main role of credit repository? Credit repository helps in distinguishing a bad and good borrower, based on which banks can provide credit to the borrower in future, and this also helps to provide a flexible interest rate mechanism by which a borrower with good credentials in the repository will get lower interest and a borrower with bad credentials in the repository would get higher interest or would not get a loan at all. So this gives a flexibility to the banking system in India. So what is the genesis of this public credit registry? The public credit registry was first proposed by the committee headed by Y.M. Dhiyoshchali, and they submitted the report on April 2018. Based on this report, RBI in June 2018 proposed that they are working on to develop public credit registry for India. Now RBI has inverted EOI, that is expression of interest, to develop this registry from the companies. The proposed PCR is different from the existing credit information utilities existing in India. We have CIBIL, Experian, and other credit information utilities in India, which collates information about the individual and corporate loan borrowers. But it doesn't provide 360-degree comprehensive. These limitations will be addressed by the PCR. Because PCR would include data from SEBI, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, Goods and Services Tax Network, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, CERSAI, that is Central Registry of Securitization, Asset Reconstruction and Security Interest, Utility Billers, and from Central Fraud Registry and Willful Defaulter List. Since they collate data from multiple sources, PCR becomes a 360-degree perspective on the credit culture of borrower. What are the advantages of setting up a PCR? PCR increases financial inclusion. It excludes willful defaulters it excludes willful defaulters, and it will help in improving the ranks of India in ease of doing business rankings. Since the data from SEBI is being collated into this public credit registry, the information about the external commercial borrowings, foreign currency convertible bonds, and other bond related capital market instruments, all this information will also be included, giving a 360 degree perspective. The last article related to prelims is about Exim Bank. Exim Bank is an financial institution that set up in 1982 for the sake of financing export-import operations in India. This is a Government of India entity headquartered in Delhi. What is the aim of this Exim Bank? The aim of Exim Bank, as I mentioned earlier, it's about financing, facilitating and promoting foreign trade from India. Exim Bank operates through the method of line of credit. It offers LOC to overseas financial institutions, regional development banks, sovereign governments and other entities abroad. Government of India, through its diplomatic missions, undertakes few developmental activities in African countries. During those diplomatic missions, government offers line of credit to those African countries. Exim Bank is the one who actually handles those line of credit. The bank also facilitates investment by Indian companies in foreign locations for setting up joint ventures, subsidiaries or overseas acquisitions. Now it's time for mains articles. We have five items taken for mains. The first one is about the continuing importance of coal in India's electricity sector. Second is about India's improved ranking and ease of doing business and how it will improve India's investment climate. Third article is about making early childhood education a priority for policy making. Fourth article is about the application of unconstitutional laws by executives in India. Fifth article is a brief explanation on Reserve Bank of India's reserves. Let's move to the first article. This infographic is taken from the Hindu. This infographic speaks about the continuing importance of coal in power production in India. Electricity powers economic growth of any country. India is a fastest growing economy in the world now. Growth of economy is synonymous with growth of industries, and growth of industries increases the demand for electricity. And this is explained here. In financial year 2018, that is now, at present the demand for electricity is around 1205 gigawatts, whereas it is going to have a compound annual growth rate of 6.7%, and it would reach the demand would reach the level of 1600 gigawatt by the end of financial year 2023. And how are we going to meet this increasing electricity demand? Any demand has to be met with a continuous supply. Improving production capacities of power plants in India is more imperative in order to meet this demand. What is the present energy mix of India? Of the total power produced in country, renewable energy sources form only around 35%, whereas the non-renewable sources form around 65%. Of them, 45% comes from coal powered plants. So coal becomes imminent in order to sustain India's economic growth. By the end of financial year 2023, the demand would have increased by 400 gigawatts. Now, what should be our energy mix in order to provide supply to that demand? As we saw earlier, the demand in 2023 would be 400 gigawatt more than the present demand. So what should be the projected energy mix in 2023 in order to cater to that demand? According to this data provided by Central Electricity Authority, coal would have a larger role to play in order to meet that demand. The infographic says that coal power thermal power plant would produce 68% of the total electricity in order to cater the demand posed by development of economy in 2023. Increased share of coal power plants has both positive and negative impacts. What are those positive impacts? With increasing urbanization happening in country, the urban settlements need more electricity in order to have a decent life. Also, the industrial areas need electricity to produce more goods. The service sector, like IT-enabled industries, they are also in need of electricity. So, improving coal power plant share electricity production in India would have positive impacts for industrial sector, whereas it has negative impacts for environment. It should be noted that in Paris Climate Accord, signed in COP21, India decided to cut down electricity production from fossil fuel. Increasing share of coal-based power plants would impact the climate change initiatives undertaken by India. Though the electricity produced from coal-based power plants lead to economic growth, we need to focus on sustainable development in order to lead a healthy life and to protect our environment. The next article is about India's improved rankings in ease of doing business index and its impact on improving investment cycle in India. This article suggests that the improvements made by India in ease of doing business ranking in certain sectors indicate the roadmap to be followed for introducing reforms in India's economy. In the recently published ease of doing business ranking, India showed improvement in these sectors. In the parameters of starting business, dealing with construction permits, getting electricity, getting credit, paying taxes, and in trading across borders, India showed improvement. These improvements were facilitated because of the measures taken by the government. Complying with the Trade Facilitation Agreement of WTO, the government had introduced a plan called as National Trade Facilitation Action Plan 2017-20 last year. Because of this plan, more technology was infused in customs and excise. This facilitated trade-related actions in India, thus improved the ranks of India in trading across parameter. Also, the single window clearance for construction introduced in Delhi and online building permit approval in Mumbai helped India to improve the ranks in construction permit parameter. So, the measures taken by the government in the areas of trade facilitation and providing construction permits helped India to improve its rank in ease of doing business. But there are also few areas where the ranks have come down. What are those parameters? The first parameter is related with insolvency and resolution. Insolvency and bankruptcy code was introduced in order to address the perennial challenge of Chakravyuha existing in India. This exit challenge, which was supposed to be solved by IBC, has resulted in loss for the financial agencies. That's because more than 80% of the cases which have been resolved under insolvency bankruptcy code has ended in liquidation. No proper resolution plan has been offered for those businesses. Only a proper resolution plan would help to revive those industries by introducing new investors and new management. Liquidating leads to haircuts for financial agencies, leads to haircuts for banks, leading to profit erosion for banks. These kinks in the armor of IBC needs to be reworked. Also, in paying taxes, India has shown a marginal decline. GST is a phenomenal and monumental change that to be introduced in the fiscal history of India. But apart from the positive effects, it has also got its inherent negative effects. One of them is the mechanism through which the input tax credit is being repaid to the exporters. The Federation of India's Exporter Organization, FIEO, they have raised this concern that this input tax credit payment
that input tax credit refund is partly manual and partly automatic. This is creating a lot of chaos and confusion. This has pulled down India's ranking in paying taxes parameter. One of the common criticism about ease of doing business index is that how can a country's real position can be explained by just studying two cities. In the case of India, it is Mumbai and New Delhi alone are surveyed. This is a valid logical argument, but the reforms undertaken in these two particular cities have produced enormous positive results for India. This indicates the direction for reforms in India. This indicates the direction for reforms that has to be undertaken in India to improve ease of doing business in India. RBI, in its also, the investment climate in India is slowly improving. In any given economy, economic policy priority should be based on three pillars. Those three pillars are investment, fiscal responsibility, structural reforms. The improved ranking in ease of doing business is indicated by the structural reforms. And investment forms an important parameter for economic policy priority. The fiscal responsibility is already being handled by the government. Now, this investment is based on both internal and external factors. For external agents to invest in India, their confidence should be boosted. And this confidence boost can be provided by this ease of doing business index. Also, if the government is working on bringing in more reforms in India, this would boost more investor confidence. In the recently concluded Monetary Policy Committee report, RBI had opined that output gap in India is almost closed. Also, the second tranche of recapitalization, the second tranche of bank recapitalization from the government is expected by the end of November 2018. This would also create a positive outlook about India's economy. The author has concluded by saying that all these activities, the reforms undertaken by India, the improvement in ease of doing business ranks, and the government actions in order to improve the capital adequacy of banks will improve the investment cycle and it will lead in upward growth of India's economy. The next article is about the importance of providing education a priority in early childhood. This article speaks about the role of ICDS in early childhood development and how this segregated Anganwadi centers in India with poor physical infrastructure has led to deterioration of noble aims, which led to creation of ICDS. First, we look into what Integrated Child Development Scheme was. This ICDS was launched in the year 1975 with the funding of UNICEF. It is mainly focused on providing nutritional and health services to the children under 0 to 6 years. So, according to census data 2011, children in the age group below 6 years constitute around 158 million of the Indian population. And this ICDS is aimed at reducing the incidence of mortality, morbidity, malnutrition and school dropout among the children of India. The ICDS operates in India through Anganwadi centers or Balwadi centers. Apart from catering the needs of children, these Anganwadi centers also takes care of the needs of pregnant ladies under the schemes of Janani Suraksha Yojana, National Nutrition Mission. These Anganwadi centers, they have three important persons. The one is the Anganwadi cook. Second is auxiliary nurse midwife. The third is ASHA, accredited social health activist. With the service offered by these three service persons, ICDS aims to achieve effective coordination of policy and implementation amongst the various departments to promote a cohesive and comprehensive child development in India. So what are the services offered under this ICDS? The ICDS scheme offers a package of 6 services, namely supplementary nutrition, preschool and non-formal education, nutrition and health education, immunization, health checkup and referral services. This health education, immunization, health checkup and referral services are undertaken by the ASHA. The supplementary nutrition is undertaken by the Anganwadi cook. The auxiliary nurse midwife, they play a major role in nutrition and health education. Economist Intelligence Unit in 2012, they undertook a survey on early childhood care and education. The report studied early childhood care and education in 45 countries. The sad point is that India ranked last among all those 45 countries. So what are the factors that led to poor performance of India in the report released by Economist Intelligence Unit? The author cites the historic 86 Amendment Act as one of the important reasons for declining quality of Anganwadi centers. 86 Constitutional Amendment Act 2002 inflicted 3 major changes in Indian Constitution. It inflicted changes in fundamental rights, directive principles of state policy, and in fundamental duties. In fundamental right, it introduced a new Article 21A. In DPSP, it amended the provisions of Article 45. And in fundamental duties, it added a new provision under Article 51A. So, because of these changes, the focus was mainly on the children between the age 6 to 14, with the focus on the children between 0 to 6 years relegated to DPSP. Though DPSP is part of important part of Constitution, it needs executive will in order to implement the provisions of DPSP. The apathy and this lack of qualitative services provided by the Anganwadi centers indicates the executive failure in implementing the provisions of Article 45. And it also indicates the need to focus on the children between 0 to 6 years, because this is the age when the cognitive development of an individual child is initiating. Providing proper nutrition, education and psychological care to children between 0 to 6 years, would these cares provided under these Anganwadi centers would develop the children into one physically and mentally healthy citizens of the country. What is the main problem that is plaguing these Anganwadi centers? The main problem is lack of physical infrastructure. And the ICDS scheme enumerates that these Anganwadi centers should have a minimum area of 600 square feet. But the existing Anganwadi centers, due to financial constraints, they are situated on rented premises which are very small to be operated, and it reduces the space for providing qualitative care to the children. The author has recommended the Rajasthan model of integrating Anganwadis with schools in order to improve the quality of Anganwadi centers in India. The next article is about the continuous application of unconstitutional laws by executive agencies. Section 66A of Information Technology Act 2000 was declared to be unconstitutional by Supreme Court. But recently in 2017, Uttar Pradesh, a person, Zakir Ali Tyagi, was arrested under Section 66A of IT Act. There has been a long precedence of applying unconstitutional penal laws. Earlier, Section 303 of IPC, which was declared to be unconstitutional in 1983, was applied in a case in Rajasthan. These two examples indicate the lack of communication between judiciary and executive in removing the unconstitutional laws from statute books. This poor enforcement of judicial declarations of unconstitutionality signals the failures between different branches of the government. The government is formed by 3 pillars. One is judiciary, the other is legislature, And the third one is executive. During the process of jurisprudence, judiciary may declare a law to be unconstitutional, but it becomes effective only when it is being acted upon by the legislature and executive. Judiciary has the power to ask the litigants for updates about compliance with its orders while hearing any case. But after finally deciding a case, the judiciary cannot ask for a report about the compliance with its orders. After deciding a case, the onus lies on executive and legislature. The failures of executive and legislature in complying with the orders of judiciary indicate the lack of effective communication between the various organs of the government. This is evident from the fact that Section 66A of IT Act and Section 303 of IPC are still existing in the statutes of Union Code of India. Apart from different organs of government, even the lower courts also are lying in the grey area of information sharing. The lack of any formal system on information sharing in the hierarchical setup of Indian judiciary has also led to the application of unconstitutional penal laws. Justice is the foremost virtue in a democracy. Justice has to be implemented by the executive in a proper manner. But in these examples mentioned earlier, judicial decisions has been at the mercy of initiatives undertaken by scrupulous officers. And this enforcement of unconstitutional laws indicates sheer waste of public money. This lack of effective communication between the different organs of the government will create problems for the vulnerable sections of the society. The vulnerable will suffer the indignity of lawless arrest and detention for no reason other than their poverty and ignorance. Also, the poor and vulnerable and marginal sections of India, they have inability to demand their rights in India, and this lack of effective communication would create nightmares for the vulnerables in India. The different organs of the government, judiciary, legislature and the executive should work in tandem in order to provide fair justice to the citizens of India.
Next article is about the composition of Reserve Bank's reserves. In the last week, we have witnessed news about the growing conflict between RBI and the government. One of the major irritants that initiated the conflict was RBI's reserves. RBI has an whopping amount of 10.46 lakh crore reserves. The center wants a cut of these reserves in order to finance its fiscal needs. But RBI considers the reserve to be an emergency buffer and it is not ready to share that buffer with the central government. Okay, what is the center's view about this RBI's reserve? The government last year proposed to infuse 2.11 lakh crore into PSPs to improve their capital adequacy. Getting the share from the RBI's reserve would help in improving the capital adequacy of banks. Getting the share from this RBI's reserves would help in improving the capital adequacy of banks. Next is about demonetization. The government had expected a windfall profit coming out of demonetization process, and those windfall profits were planned to be invested in various developmental activities. Almost 99% of demonetized currency is back into circulation again, and because of this, the windfall profit didn't happen. This made the government to think about new avenues for funding its developmental activities. Apart from all these macroeconomic reasons, there is another popular reason, because 2019 is election year. It is common in Indian political system to provide more SOPs and developmental schemes during election year in order to please the voters. These are the three viewpoints offered by the central government. What are the viewpoints offered by the RBI? The RBI says that these reserves of RBI has been built from the higher seigniorage income. What is a seigniorage income? Seigniorage income is a difference between the value of new notes printed by the RBI and the costs of printing and distribution. From the higher seigniorage income and from the interest offered by the central government to the central bank for holding their government securities, RBI has improved their reserves. As on June 2018, the RBI had 10.46 lakh crore in reserves. Of them, the bulk components were only two heads, and bulk of these reserves is under two heads.
The first one is the currency and gold revaluation reserve. The second one is the contingency reserves. Currency, gold revaluation reserve and the contingency reserves are built through transfers from annual surpluses in profit and loss account of RBI. The surplus in these two accounts are given back to the government as RBI's dividend. RBI feels that this reserves is maintained in order to provide emergency buffer. What is the aim of maintaining these reserves by RBI? First, to protect India's money from losing its value. Now we have witnessing the volatility of rupee due to various macroeconomic reasons. This reserve can be used as a tool to protect Indian rupee from being affected by this volatility. Also, this contingency reserve could also be used to cover the depreciation in the value of RBI holdings of government bonds, be it domestic or foreign. Economies are always marked with extraordinary events. One such example is demonetization. This reserve would act as a buffer to cover expenses from those extraordinary events. The confidence of an economy lies in the proper functioning of its banks, and the confidence of banks is maintained by RBI's role as lender of the last resort. This reserves maintained by RBI augments the role of RBI in being a lender of last resort. In order to protect the consumer interest, the government has formed a Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation as a wholly owned subsidiary of RBI. During the case of bankruptcy or failure of a bank, this Deposit Insurance Credit Guarantee Corporation provides insurance to the depositors. This reserve acts as an important source for providing deposit insurance and credit guarantee for the citizens of India. The article mentions about setting up a committee to maintain these reserves. The committee should have representatives from the government, reserve bank, economists, and the market representatives. This committee will go into the different aspects of RBI's balance sheet, and based on that deep analysis, they suggest a safe buffer and a fair method for sharing the reserves if at all there any need rises to share the reserves with the government. Thank you.